In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Two weeks ago, we heard in the Gospel reading about the baptism of Jesus by John the Baptist. That momentous and life-defining event reversed their lives when the Spirit of God came upon Jesus, and the voice from heaven declared him to be the Son of God. John had been sent to prepare the way for Jesus, and as he baptizes him, appears to be the first to acknowledge the adult Jesus as the Messiah. Indeed, some 30 years or so earlier, we're told in Luke's Gospel that even in his mother Elizabeth's womb, the still to be born John somehow recognized who Jesus was in the womb of his own mother Mary as he jumped about with joy. And in today's Gospel reading, the very first thing we hear is that John has been arrested. And this is at the very beginning of what we know to be the ministry of Jesus. And it begins with his cousin John, the man who not long ago had baptized him. It begins with him being arrested. What a very inauspicious start to the public ministry of the one who was meant to be anointed by God. I imagine that Jesus was probably pretty concerned about what happened to John, but the Gospel writer doesn't fill us in on those details. Instead, he moves straight on to tell us of Jesus moving away from Nazareth to the small village of Capernaum by the Sea of Galilee, in order, according to the writer of Matthew's Gospel, to fulfill the words of the prophet Isaiah. He begins to proclaim a very similar message to the one preached by John. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. And when John said these words, they would be seen as preparing people for the arrival of the one who would bring about this kingdom of heaven. Yet spoken by Jesus, however, in the light of John's recognition of him as the Messiah, these words take on a great deal of extra significance. No longer are they the words of a man who is merely laying the ground for what was to come, but rather they are now the words of the one who brought about the fulfillment of John's proclamation. The kingdom of heaven in the person of Jesus was indeed very near. And it wasn't just a reference to some future state of bliss or paradise. This was a kingdom that was manifest in the very present reality of Jesus' words and actions. It certainly wasn't just some wishy-washy abstract notion that looked only at some future reward, but it was grounded in the real lives of real people, and how they're related to one another as well as to God. He comes across a group of fishermen at work and simply tells them to follow him, and we're told they do so immediately. These fishermen are the first people that we are told of, other than John, who responded to the call of Christ and obeyed. Now I'm sure that for most of us, if we're at work or even if we're just sitting in the cabin at Brighton, that some random person came up to us and told us to follow them, and maybe we'll think about it for a while, and then we'd probably start running in the opposite direction, wondering why we're attracting the crazy people today. Yet to those first few disciples, there must have been something pretty compelling for them to simply down tools and immediately follow Jesus. He relates to them in the way that they know best, as he tells them that he will make them fish for people. He meets with them in the reality of right where they are. This marked the beginning of their journey with Christ, as they too became standard bearers of his message about the kingdom of heaven. So what was this kingdom? If it wasn't just some future reward only to be attained after living a good and upright life, it was so much more than this. We get a glimpse of it at the end of the Gospel reading, when we hear that Jesus went throughout Galilee teaching in their synagogues and preaching the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. In a very real and practical way, he displays the love of God to people in whatever situation they found themselves. The kingdom of heaven often challenged the status quo, as we see Jesus speak out against the injustice and hypocrisy that was so prevalent around him. It was not something that was easily available to those amongst whom Jesus would go on to perform his ministry, the tax collectors, the prostitutes, the lepers, the sinners. But Jesus walked amongst these people, offering his unconditional love and acceptance, and claiming to be bringing the kingdom of heaven, was really something quite radical, and in the eyes of many at that time, made him out to be a dangerous subversive who should be eliminated. Those early followers of Jesus would eventually learn and come to understand what it meant, not only to proclaim the good news, but also to demonstrate it in their own lives. But for now, they simply obeyed his call and followed. But what does all this talk of the kingdom of heaven being near have to do with us today, 2,000 years later? In the same way it was near then, I think it's equally true to say it's near now. In the words, actions, and the lives of those who even today choose to obey the call of Christ and reaching out to those around them. Do we see ourselves as people who show in our attitude towards others what it means to be a follower of Christ? It's in the simple action of keeping an eye out for a neighbour or helping them to get the groceries in. And it's in standing alongside those who, in our own community and even beyond, who are on the margins and often struggle to cope. I suggested much of the work of the community centre downstairs is in a very practical way what it means to say that the kingdom of heaven is near. The many groups downstairs that cater to a huge diversity of people's needs within our own community. It's not always about overt evangelism or pushing religion down people's throats. Rather, it's simply about ordinary people like you and me making themselves available to others at their point of need. I'm reminded of the words of Teresa of Avila, who wrote, "Christ has no body but yours, no hands, no feet on earth but yours. Yours are the eyes with which he looks compassion on the world. Yours are the feet with which he walks to do good. Yours are the hands with which he blesses all the world." We're so often reminded that the church is the body of Christ, his visible presence here on earth. And when we allow ourselves to be vessels for taking something of the kingdom of heaven to others, we enter in a very real way what it means to be the feet, the hands, and yes, the body of Christ. And it's in reaching out to others with no strings, no preconditions, and often beyond our own comfort zone, that we show them Jesus, and we get a glimpse of just how near the kingdom of heaven is, even here in our own community. Amen.